carriage and content has been successfully. Difference there. A transmission like to a load, the last mile connectivity, the last mile supply, and the ultimate recovery of revenues which goes on to pay the transmission licensee, the distribution licensee, and also the generating company. So unless there is a sufficient and effective method to actually recover this amount, the entire sector is in doldrums, as Professor Rao has and Harry has also rightly pointed out. I think the intent of having the separation of carriage and content is quite noble, because ultimately I think the two major areas that the government has tried to address through the separation of content and carriage is of consumer choice in terms of the supplier, and which also transforms into cheaper and quality service supply of electricity.
But Sakya, don't you see a contradiction? On the one hand, as S.L. Rao also said, that you're talking about competition and you're talking about consumer choice. But on the other hand, we're talking about, as Naganand said, creeping regulation even on generation. So how do you think this is panning out?
I'll just come to that, Harry. I'm you know, just trying to lay out the broad
landscapes.
Yeah. Thank you. Where this separation has been suggested in the amendment bill, and then I'll go into the various issues arising from this. So basically, if I look at it, the idea is of competition, as Harry pointed out, but the question is to whose benefit? Because one of the primary areas of concern that I see is that now statutorily, the regulator will have no control over how open access is phased out. And consumers, ultra consumers above 1 megawatt have been given an automatic clearance for open access. It's just a few days back, I was reading a book on participative democracy. The interesting thing about democracy is that it is the decisions are never for the benefit of all. It can't be, because everyone has different issues to address. So according to political thinkers, the focus of democracy should be to address an issue in a manner so that it tries to resolve the issue in the best possible manner, reaching out to the maximum number of stakeholders. When we talk about open access, and I have always had this view, I think open access is a good concept, but is it applicable in the Indian context is one of the issues. Now, when you look at the consumer profile across states in India, there are a large number of people who are yet to become consumers. There's no electricity available to a large number of consumers. Professor Rao has and the bill also has suggested a decentralized distribution, which I think is a good initiative in that direction. Having said so, then you have large number of consumers who may not be in the best possible position to pay the average cost of supply that a distribution licensee has in terms of procuring of power and also maintaining its own distribution facilities.
Sakya, sorry to interrupt you, but I'm very impatient.
Yeah.
My question is, if that is the case, if I can't afford to buy a Mercedes-Benz car, then should I get a Mercedes-Benz car? Or if I can't afford a scooter, do I have to get a scooter because I'm a citizen of India?
See, Harry, if you see, and this I have to tell you, you know, purely from a constitutional point of view, the right to life and the right to a dignified mode of living, which is you know, which is underlined under Article 14, Red Book 21, and other you know, fundamental rights, provides that every citizen of India should have the right to have a dignified and a reasonable standard of life.
Fair point. But where does it say that under Article so-and-so that you can buy electricity or get electricity and not pay for it if you can't afford it?
That's exactly where I'm coming to, Harry.
Okay.
So, you know, that's exactly the issue, because, you know, one can very easily say that, look, if you are living in a jhuggi jhopri, if you can't afford the cost of power at 3 rupees or 4 rupees per unit, you know, buy some kerosene, you know, burn some lamp, or burn some candle, you know, why should you be aspiring to have electricity to run a TV or, you know, probably charge your mobile also. But the issue is exactly this, that our government, various state governments can actually not sit, you know, hand in hand and, you know, and just pretend to look away from the requirements of people who are living below poverty line or are not in a position to pay the cost of power. And there comes the conflict, because ultimately, if you see Section 43 of the Act, and which is now, I don't know how it's going to pan out once the distribution and supply is separated, there's a universal supply obligation, which means that anybody or any premises situated within a supply area has the right under statute to ask for power and be supplied with electricity. The question is, well, if you want, then you have to be able to pay for it. But there comes a question of equality and equity. Equality is about trying to give the similar treatment to everybody. Equity, and which is the underlying principle of our constitution, is to actually hold hands with those who are not yet at a level to compete with others, to actually support them through the state system so that they can also come up and have certain basic requirements of life and living met. And so the issue of cross-subsidy comes in. Basically, I think cross-subsidy is ultimately a function of this constitutional requirement that those who have must, to a certain extent, compensate towards the cost for those who have not or do not have the ability to pay for that power.
May I ask a question?
Yes,
please.
Yeah, go ahead.
Where in the Constitution does it say this? Where in the Constitution does it say that the...
Like I said, sir, it's a question of
equity.
Why is it that the people with higher income are subjected to a higher tax slab, while those, I think now the tax exemption is 4 lakhs under the present budget.
Sakya, sir, we are running a little behind schedule.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do is,
yeah,
I'm going to be a pain in the neck, okay, and we're not talking on the subject. But let me just say this to the audience, since this seems to be the flavor. I'm reading a 4 lines about exactly what you're saying in the point that Professor Rao raised, which is the underlying crux of why these amendments are happening and why things are not happening, and why is it that those who have electricity are unhappy and those who don't have electricity are unhappy. Indeed, the distribution of wealth is too important an issue to be left to economists, sociologists and historians and philosophers. It is of interest to everyone, and that is a good thing. The concrete physical reality of inequality is visible to the naked eye and naturally inspires sharp but contradictory political judgments. Peasant and noble, worker and factory owner, waiter and banker, each has his own unique vantage point and sees important aspects of how other people live and what relations of power and domination exist between social groups. And these observations shape each person's judgment of what is and is not just. So may I suggest that we come specifically to carriage content because we are behind schedule.
Yeah, okay. So Harry, what I'll do is, I think, you know, I'm kind of going on a philosophical tangent. So I'll break this up very specifically into the issues with regarding to a single distribution license and a number of supply licensees under the you know, separation of carriage and content. The single distribution license, I mean, what the amendment provides is that whoever is having a distribution license, as in a distribution network, will become the incumbent distribution licensee. Now, under the amendment, what is also provided is that the minimum period for the license will be 25 years, unless, of course, your license is revoked for ABC reasons. So that basically brings in two issues. First is, you have only a monopolist in terms of the distribution licensee or the network licensee. And the second is that he has a secured tenure of 25 years. Now that brings in issues and severe, serious issues with regarding to competition. Anybody who has some amount of background into the competition law or the antitrust law will know that one of the reasons why competition is in fact encouraged is to improve upon quality, to look at innovations, to reduce prices. When you have a monopolist distribution licensee who has a tenure for 25 years, purely as a monopoly, there seems to be hardly any motivation for either of them.
So what's going to happen now once they separate?
So Harry, very simply, you will, the incumbent licensee is not going to look at more innovative ways of improving the distribution network. Why should he? Because ultimately, you know, he can
there's no debate on that. The debate is, how can it possibly be done, and if so, what is the impact? So let's get specifically into the nuts and bolts. That supposing we say a distribution company is broken up into wires and supply, now what happens?
So
put a diagram up just to, for the people to react.
Yeah. So So Harry, what I'm actually addressing is that under the act as it today is, the Proviso 6 to Section 14 actually allows for a parallel network to come up. Now, parallel network has its own disadvantages in terms of, you know, having stranded capacity, high entry costs, you know,
and duplication of network
as well.
Fair point.
But there is always a risk with the incumbent licensee that if he is not performing, there is somebody else who can actually take over. But that doesn't seem to be the issue with a single distribution licensee. Second issue that I have with a single distribution licensee, and this probably needs to a certain extent should have been addressed in the act, is now everybody is an open access consumer. Even the supply licensees under the act in effect are open access consumers, because ultimately they'll need open access through the distribution network. So who has primacy? Is it an open access per se, consumer per se under Section 42, or the supply licensee who needs the network now to supply to his consumers?
Hold on. So what you're saying is a supply licensee is also an open access consumer, which means he'll be subject to a cross subsidy surcharge for somebody?
they have the they haven't used the term open access for supply licensees, but if in effect what you see is that ultimately he has to get that open access from the distribution licensee. I mean, the writing's on the wall. Of course, it is a, you know, the CSS has been applied only for the open access consumers under section 42, but I'm on a slightly different issue. I'm on the issue of who gets primacy in terms of user of the network. And since you have more than one licensee, it's already clear. There are
regulations on this. Who's got a mic? Can someone give a mic to the table here, please? Mic control.